morning from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet are well known, as dying and seen. We are alive, as punished, and yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the Holy Gospel.
The Holy Gospel this morning is a reading from St. Mark, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On that day when evening had come, Jesus said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." So leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat just as he was. And other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But Jesus was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. You may be seated. I was thinking maybe just to begin with, we probably don't do this enough to honor the Christian men who are fathers in our midst. You might be sitting next to your father, maybe not, but if you are, why don't we just offer this blessing for them as we begin our time together. I mean, the church is in great need of strong men, certainly to be leaders and examples of the faith, and so I think any encouragement that the church can provide for that is a good thing, a very good thing. And any time that we can offer thanks to our own fathers, or maybe our husbands who've been fathers to our children, right? Maybe it's good to offer them a blessing. So let's just begin with that. So if you're sitting next to a father, or if you're sitting next to your husband who is a father, maybe you could just lay their hand on them, and we'll begin our reflection time with a brief prayer. So let us pray. Almighty God, you've set all of us as individuals into families, and may our families always be strengthened by your Holy Spirit. You bring all of us mercy, and you nurture us. So bless all who have the joy and the responsibility of fatherhood this day. We're grateful for fathers who have built up their children with gentleness, who break out of stereotypes of strength to provide true, quiet support for them. We give you thanks for fathers who are husbands as well, as they keep family as a priority in life. So we pray now for fathers who might feel a heavy burden. We pray for fathers who find difficulty in aspects of their lives. We pray that you would steady and that you would center them, O God, as part of your family. So God, in your great mercy, bless our fathers. Enable each to foster lasting and life-giving relationships with all people. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for that. I just want to announce, I want to welcome all of the visitors that are with us today. Certainly, you're invited to join us for Holy Communion as we celebrate open communion for anyone who are baptized and who believe that the bread and the wine is the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So welcome to worship today. We also want to welcome, I know you have good memories, but we want to welcome back to our congregation our former intern, Pastor John, and his wife, Krista, and their daughter, Eliana, and they're becoming new parents. John is becoming a new father, so we welcome the baby unknown, too, and we just celebrate with you today. They are on the way to their first call assignment in Eastern Washington, Grandview, Washington. What a name, to be called to Grandview. Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Grandview, Washington. Is there a Grandview there? I suppose there is a Grandview there. But let's just congratulate them and thank God for God's work as God continues to call pastors to serve in the church. This is proof, Pastor Ryan, that you'll make it. You'll survive internship. He's still alive, and you'll make it. Some days he looks a little worried. We're not worried. Well, Jesus and his friends are tired from a long day. It's been a long day of teaching for them. In other words, the Gospel of Mark makes it clear that it was a day of teaching. It wasn't a day of miracles. Miracles tend to change us when we witness or experience a miracle ourselves. They change us, but this wasn't a day of miracles. No demons have been cast out this day. No blind men have received their sight this day. No little girls have been raised from the dead this day. Though those stories and those times when you're walking with Jesus and he performs miracles, those will tend to change you and change your life. But here in the text, none of that is, it's just been a day of teaching. Jesus has been teaching, the disciples have been teaching, and so it's more like just an ordinary day. It's more like just another day at the office that the Gospel of Mark gives us in the text today. A fairly ordinary day, but still, Jesus seems to want an out-of-ordinary experience for his closest friends. And so he says to them, let us go across to the other side. Let us go across to the other side of the sea, that is. And maybe Jesus is just trying to get us to the other side. Have you ever thought about that? I mean, maybe Jesus is just trying to change those disciples. And maybe Jesus is trying to get you to the other side. Maybe Jesus is trying to get you to grow in faith or to grow in life. Maybe Jesus is trying to get you to something else in your life, to get to the other side. So Jesus says, let us go. Let us go to the other side. Let us go across to the other side. And Jesus says this because it's always easy to stay where we're at, right? It's always easy for us to just stay right here, to stay right where we've been for a long time, to stay in our, what we call our comfort zones. It's easy for us to just stay right here. But Jesus says, let us go across to the other side. I mean, we would rather ignore, I think, that need for change in our lives, even when we hear Jesus' voice calling us to that change. would just rather ignore it. Because change is hard. Change is difficult. So we don't want to change. We just want to sit, or we want to stand right where we're at, and we wait. We wait. But what do we wait for? The right time? Do we wait for someone else to make the first move? Well, Jesus does. He makes the first move in his words, "Let us go across to the other side." Jesus seems rather dissatisfied with letting us live on one side of the lake for too long. So when he invites us to go to the other side. And getting to the other side is no easy task. It is no easy task. Nor should we expect it to be an easy task, for that matter. Change is always difficult. Moving from one place to another is rarely without its challenges. Getting to the other side means going through some rough and tough waters, and that's what happens when Jesus tries to move us from one place to another. But that's also the nature of change. Change is hard, but the harder truth is staying where you are at when Jesus wants you to go somewhere else. That's even more difficult for us. So we have this great story that we gather around of this story of Jesus calming the storm. And we have this great story too right in front of us, right? How many of you, you remember that story? That story is not this story in the text, but it comes later in the Gospel of Mark. But the similar thing to both stories is look at the waves. Look at the water. The storm there too. That's Jesus walking on the water, and he invites Peter to come along and look at the water. It's a rough place out there in the sea, isn't it? And here in the text too, it tells us that a storm arises. Well, because it's summer, and because of some of you might spend some time at the lake, I think, or maybe some of you are even listening to our worship right now at the lake, and we're happy for that. You know, and because I grew up in a little town called Lake Benton, and I spent a lot of time not just around the lake, but actually in the lake, I think it's important that I remind myself that this is not a story about the lakes that we like to think about. A place for recreation, a place for vacation, a place for hanging out with friends and family, or a place for joy or abandon or refreshment or relaxing delight. The lake or the Sea of Galilee that's described here in the Gospel of Mark and other Gospels is much different than what we would like to think about when we go to the lake. This story from Mark's Gospel bears no resemblance of my and probably your understanding of the sea. Instead, Mark speaks of this place as a place that is seen as a place of work. It's a place of labor. It's a dangerous one for fishing families who live on its shores. It is a place that is capricious and terrifying because it is large and it is shallow, and the Sea of Galilee is prone to sudden and violent storms when the winds rise up, storms which disappear just as quickly when the winds die down. One that evokes, even for ancient people who inhabit Galilee, and even more of the ancient creation stories in which the world arises out of this chaos. So the sea, this lake, represents that chaos in our lives. It represents this powerful, primitive, and untamable place. The sea, as Mark sees it, as Jesus and his friends experience it, is not your typical summer vacation spot at the lake. It is a force of almost supernatural magnitude, and it is something to be reckoned with. And that is the nature of change, isn't it? That is the nature of moving, or Jesus moving us from one spot to another spot because that's difficult for us to move. And one of the reasons why it's difficult for us to move is when my location changes, when I go somewhere else, my perspective changes in life. My perspective changes of you. My perspective changes of the world. And when I move to a different location, then your perspective needs to change as well, right? Now I'm over here. You see, for those of you who are listening, I'm moving around the sanctuary. That's what, when we change location, that's what it does for us. And maybe it even changes the perspective that we have of ourselves. And certainly when we change location, it changes the perspective that we have of Jesus and of God. Now, I know that some of you have been through some change. I'm not saying that God causes all change, but if you've experienced some change in your life, my prayer is that you have been able to see God's hand there, giving you strength, and maybe even giving you wisdom. Because that can happen too when we experience change, when we have to go to a different location. It's scary. It's hard. I realize that. Maybe Christ is calling some of you to change right now. Maybe it's literally a new place to serve the gospel. But maybe for some of you, it's a new place, maybe just to get through the day. You just want to get through the other side, or to the other side of this day. And our prayer for you is that you will see the hand of God guiding you and leading you through that. The thing about this text, and I'm sure that you've noticed it, it's hard not to notice. When we read this text, you know it, the disturbing thing, I mean, in the disturbing waters of change, even perhaps the most disturbing thing is what? Jesus is asleep, right? Mark tells us that Jesus is asleep on the cushion in the midst of this change, in the midst of this storm. Jesus is sleeping. That's not my favorite image of God. When we need Jesus the most, he's sleeping. Jesus is supposed to be with us, right? I think about that psalm, the one who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. That's how I prefer to think of God. That's how I prefer to think about Jesus. Not slumbering, not asleep on the job, but Jesus that is awake. But here Jesus is asleep, and that's kind of hard to take, isn't it? But what does Jesus say? Let me remind you. Jesus says to us, let us go across to the other side. Jesus doesn't say, you go across to the other side. Jesus says, let us go across the other side together. So we know Jesus is with us through all the chaos, through all the disturbance, through all the turmoil, through all the hardship, through all the joy. Jesus remains with us. So might we say to Jesus the same as Jesus says to us? Jesus, let us go across to the other side. Can we say that together? Jesus, let us go across to the other side. One more time. Jesus, let us go across to the other side. Amen. Well, before we sing, I had Pastor Ryan find this prayer for me. I want to do this prayer for you. This is the prayer that the bishop used when he was re-elected as our bishop last weekend, and it's a great prayer. So will you pray with me? It's found in our ELW, but it's a great prayer. O God, you call your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.